bring it down here. You're way over here. Just trying to work with me. Nope, too far, too far. Come back. How about zoom out, please? Zoom out, maybe. No, too far. Zoom back in. Come on. Stop. Zoom out. Frame up. Let's get it in focus. There we go. Doing things the hard way. Let's talk about that. Hey guys, this is Andrew with another Sabbath School short, and this week we're looking at lesson number 4, which is titled The Hard Way. And the memory text for this week is Isaiah chapter 8, verse 17. And it says, I will wait on the Lord who hides his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. And the lesson opens up with a story about a burning building in New York City's Harlem and a blind girl who was perched on the fourth floor of the building, and how the firemen they kind of became desperate. They couldn't fit the ladder truck in between the alley where she was, so they put a net down below, but obviously she couldn't see, and they were telling her to jump, and she wouldn't. And she wouldn't jump until she heard the voice of her father telling her to jump. And it was in this moment that she decided to jump with ease, and she had complete 100% trust because she knew it was the voice of her father telling her to jump. And the quote that really jumped out at me at the end of this story in Sabbath Afternoon's lesson, it says, in the same way, God provided powerful evidence that he wanted the best for his children, but they rejected the gently flowing way he first presented to them. Thus, he had to speak to them with a roar and a flood instead. And you see, God is always trying to speak to us gently at first. He's trying to appeal to us in a very gentle way, but sometimes we humans, we get a little stubborn. We have a little bit of pride that builds up within us, right? And because of this, God sometimes has to resort to other means to try to grab our attention and to get us to really think about what he's trying to tell us. And that's kind of what this lesson is all about, and how this happened with the people of Judah during the time of Isaiah's prophetic ministry. So looking over at Sunday's lesson, which is titled Prophecy Fulfilled. Prophecy Fulfilled. And it kind of brings up the prophecy that is given in Isaiah chapter 7, verses 14 through 16, specifically talking about the section where it says, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted, and talking about how this prophecy was actually fulfilled in 732, within about 2 years of Isaiah's prediction, because Syria and Israel had been defeated by Assyria. Remember last week we talked about how Ahaz rallied up with Assyria to defeat them, and like I said in the short term last week, we said in the short term it worked, but Assyria eventually turned around and conquered Judah and conquered King Ahaz as well. But it was all over for the two kings that had threatened King Ahaz, and this prophecy was fulfilled. And the quote that kind of jumped out at me here, it says, God had predicted what would happen to the enemies of Judah, but his point to Ahaz was that this would happen anyway, without any need to rely on Assyria. And I think this lesson kind of brings out is that the events that are recorded in biblical prophecy, the prophetic events that are recorded, do not depend on human cooperation, but rather it depends on the sovereignty of God. Because God said this would happen, it is going to happen. And we can have hope in the prophecies of the Bible that especially like thinking about the book of Revelation that prophesies about the future, many times even the current events that we're living in right now, we can kind of see it unfolding in our eyes, before our eyes. And this idea that God is speaking through these words, therefore they're going to happen, and we can hold on to faith that they are going to happen, and we can have hope in the authority of the Word of God because its prophecies are true. Whether or not we cooperate with God or not, these big events that the Bible talks about will happen. Speaking of events happening, looking at Monday's lesson, which is titled Foreseen Consequences, right? Foreseen Consequences. And the quote that jumped out at me says, by turning down God's freely offered deliverance, Ahaz was guaranteed defeat. If Ahaz thought his world was falling apart now, things were only going to get worse. And this prophecy in Isaiah chapter 7, verses 17 through 25 that the lesson is talking about all prophesy of how things are going to get worse. And it's because Ahaz decided to rally and ally himself with his enemy rather than ally himself with God. And I want to read something that the lesson brings out in 2 Chronicles chapter 28, verses 20 through 23, because it summarizes this very well. Starting in verse 20 in chapter 28 of 2 Chronicles. It says, then King Tiglath-Pileser of Assyria came against Ahaz. He oppressed him and did not give him support. Although Ahaz plundered the Lord's temple and the palace of the king and of the rulers and gave the plunder to the king of Assyria, it did not help him. At a time of his distress, King Ahaz himself became more unfaithful to the Lord. He sacrificed to the gods of Damascus, which had defeated him. He said, since the gods of the kings of Aram are helping them, I will sacrifice to them so that they will help me. But they were the downfall of him and of all Israel. You see, the reason why Israel fell was because Ahaz decided to not trust God and trust Assyria instead. So looking over at Tuesday, which is titled, What's in a Name? And the quote that jumped out at me there, it says, when Isaiah legally recorded the boy's name, even before his conception, he made the child and his name a public prophecy that could be tested by subsequent events. And it's talking about Isaiah chapter 8. We're in Isaiah chapter 8 now, verses 1 through 10, where Isaiah has a child and they name him Meher Shalal Hashbaz, which means speed the spoil or hasten the plunder. And it's this idea that this name of this child was a public prophecy of what was going to happen to the nation of Israel. Because now this prophecy is extending to Judah, it's extending to them as well, as Assyria was going to come and conquer it because of Ahaz's decision. But even though this was going to happen, another quote that kind of jumped out at me from this lesson, it says, indeed, what we see here is a theme that permeates the entire book of Isaiah, which is though there would be judgments on God's enemies in Judah and other nations, delivered in the form of military diseases, suffering, and exile, the Lord would be with the faithful survivors of his people and restore them to their land. So the Lord is with the faithful and restores them. This speaks to us today because although we see crazy events happening around us, these disasters, these terrible things that are happening around us, if we stay faithful to God, we can have faith that he will restore us, just as he was going to restore his people that were faithful to him back in Isaiah's day. And because of this, we have nothing to fear but God himself, which is what Wednesday's lesson is about. And it says, nothing to fear when we fear God himself. And the quote that really jumped out at me here, because this is talking about Isaiah chapter 8, verses 11 through 15, where it says to not fear any of the conspiracies around, but rather give fear to God himself, which is what Isaiah was telling the people back then. And this quote speaks to this when it says, true fear of God as holy means that you recognize him as the ultimate power in the universe. Such fear overcomes any other fear. If he is for you, nobody else can touch you without his permission. If he is against you because you have rebelled against him, you can run, but you can't hide. And the lesson kind of brings out this idea of fearing God and what that actually means. Because you see, there's different kinds of fear depending on where you stand with God. If you're with God, your fear of him is of awe and respect of who he is and how you do not measure up in the slightest, and yet he still loves you. That's that kind of that fear, right? But then there's this other fear that if you're against him, because he's so holy, he's so perfect, he's all powerful, he's an enemy to you. So if he's for you, you're overcome with awe and wonder, but if you're against him, he's your biggest threat, and that way you fear him. And that's kind of how it works. You know, you think of 1 John 4:18, like perfect love casts out fear. Doesn't that contradict to fear God? Well, no, this fear is of awe and respect about who God is, because you recognize that he loves you and you love him. But if you're his enemy, it's bad news. It's bad news. So looking over at Thursday's lesson, which is titled Gloom of the Ungrateful Living Dead, looking at Isaiah chapter 8, verses 16 through 22. And the quote that really jumped out at me there, it says, separation from the occult is a matter of loyalty to God. 1 Chronicles 10:13 and 14 applies this principle to the case of King Saul. So Saul died for his unfaithfulness. He was unfaithful to the Lord in that he did not keep the command of the Lord. Moreover, he had consulted a medium seeking guidance and did not seek guidance from the Lord. Therefore, the Lord put him to death and turned the kingdom over to David, son of Jesse. And it's talking about how King Ahaz kind of did the same thing as King Saul did, because he was deeply involved with pagan religion. He was disregarding God, and he was just very much involved with these pagan religions. And this lesson specifically talks about occult and consulting the dead as a way to disregard God. But I think this kind of, in a general sense, applies to so much more. And I think it applies in this sense. Who or what are you turning to for guidance? When I look at my life, who am I turning to guidance for? Or what am I turning to guidance for? If it's anything other than God, It's not a good place to be. And I think this lesson is really trying to communicate to us that we need to make sure that as Christians, we're consulting God and letting God lead our lives. And absolutely nothing else can fit that role except for God. And kind of jumping down in Friday, the further thought section, there's a long quote from Ellen White that really drives this point home of the occult and how Ahaz was trusting in the pagan religions rather than in God, and how King Saul was consulting mediums, and how that is detrimental to our walk with God. But I encourage you to go read that, but I just want to read the summary that summarizes this whole lesson because I think it's really powerful. It says, though through Isaiah's actions and family as well as his words, God reinforced the message of warning and hope. The only safe course is to trust that God knows what he is doing. He has both the love and the power to guide, protect, and provide for those who let him. For those who turn to other powers, there is only gloom. And so as we're living in this world and as God is having to let the world spin into chaos so that we can recognize that sin is bad and God is good, hold on to God and trust in him, and that way you can be that remnant faithful. When he comes again, he's going to restore and bring back to himself so that one day when he comes again, we can go up into the clouds with him and be with him forever. And I cannot wait for that day. It's going to be a great day. So let's trust in him and trust our lives to him. I hope you guys enjoyed this week's Sabbath School Short. As always, if you could leave a thumbs up for this video and subscribe to Advent Blueprint and drop a comment down below. How has your journey been trying to seek guidance from God? Has it been hard? Have you heard amazing things from God, the voices from God? Or has he been silent? What has your journey been like? We love to talk with you, help you, encourage you as you try to seek guidance from him and put your life in his hands. I hope you guys enjoyed this week's Sabbath School Short, and we'll see you on the next one.